But here, though, at the end of July, you know, when it's, around 90 degrees, supposed to be, or no, 90 degrees all week, we don't always think, whoo, winter thoughts, do we? Somebody thinking, man, I wish winter would get here so it wouldn't be so hot. But then when it's wintertime, we're complaining too, right? Oh, man, it's so cold. Aren't happy, are we? Of course, here at the end of July, it's 90 degrees all week. Are we thinking about decorations and trees and lights and programs and parades and shopping and traveling and cookies? Got to have cookies at Christmas time, right? Got to have cookies. It's just not the same. Got to have cookies. But not them sugar cookies, right? Oh, I see a frowny face. They're not my favorite. She likes them. But you know. But we're going to look at a familiar story during a not-so-typical time. Hopefully we'll have open hearts, open minds, and we will simply adore Jesus. So if you're in Luke 2, Matthew 2, or they're in the back of our hymnals, 529, it's the Savior's Advent, and 530 is Adoration of the Magi. I'll read, you guys can follow along, but sorry that we know it. We just need to play the Charlie Brown Christmas, right? Have Linus come up here with his blanket. But even though, so when Linus tells this Christmas story, he doesn't have hold of his blanket. So 529, and then we'll do 530. So it does come from Luke 2 and from Matthew 2. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you was born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told unto them. And then we'll go into the Magi. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and are come to worship him. When Herod had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared, and he sent them to Bethlehem and said, Go and search diligently for the young child. And when ye have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also. When they had heard the king, they departed. And lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of God in the dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. Stories of the shepherds and the wise men from Luke 2 and Matthew 2. But there's just some things I want to point out today about the shepherds. Maybe we don't always think about it. Maybe we've heard it and maybe it's slipped our memory. Maybe it isn't always brought out. And then, of course, the things about the wise men. And Luke 2:16, of course, in our hymnal where we did had the reading from, it doesn't. I'll have the verses. So if you wanted to flip there in your translation real quick to 2:16, say that the shepherds came in haste. They did it quickly. And your versions may say something similar. They came quickly. They didn't wait. Yeah. This one says they hurried. And then in 17 and 18, you read that the shepherds made known what they had heard, and all those who heard it marveled. They were in awe. They were astonished at what they heard. And then in 2:20, we read that the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. Because we were just out in the fields, minding our own business, taking care of the sheep, and poof, angels. We're so afraid. We were blessed to be told this. We should make this known to everybody. Maybe the short, condensed version of what happened. Then are we like the shepherds in regard to haste? Do we do things quickly? Do we like to take our time? Or do we not want to do things at all? Of course, that is in regards to what God would have of us, what God has shown us, what God has done for us, what God would ask us to do. Of course, when we hear from God and He chooses to speak in a variety of ways, He can speak in that still small voice when we're just quiet. Sometimes maybe for some of us, we may not always want to be quiet. Some of us want to do, go, and always have things on and doing, which makes it harder to hear the still, small voice, right? If I'm always loud. Sometimes you think, well, am I loud on purpose? Maybe I want to drown him out, which then that's the personal thing. Well, maybe I shouldn't be so loud. God can speak to us through a song. That's our preset number one in both of our cars, Christian music. Then we know there's other presets, but preset one is it's Christian music. And God can speak through that. He can speak through a message, through a Sunday school lesson, through a Bible study. Of course, He can definitely speak to us through prayer. Maybe the kind word of, we might think, a stranger. But God can speak. And when He does speak, again, do we act promptly? The shepherds went right away. The angels have told us this. We should go now and check it out. Or do we delay? We could go tomorrow. when it's daylight, and it'd be easier to, you know, find the place. They went right away. Or do we completely ignore God? Yeah, God, you've spoken, but we ignore it. I mean, it's really what we can do, right? We can do it right away, we can do it eventually, or not at all. And perhaps we've all been there at each particular time. We've probably done things right away. Yes, that's exciting. I want to do it. I'm gifted that way. Let's go. Oh, or we don't do it. Do we tell everyone, or even anyone for that matter, what we've been told and what we've seen? The shepherds did. They told everyone. We don't know who that everyone is. They came in contact with 8 people, 30 people, hundreds of people, thousands of people. I mean, Bethlehem was crowded at the time. Could have been a whole lot of people there who had to register, pay their taxes. Could have been a lot of folk. But that wouldn't we marvel if someone said, "Hey guys, I saw an angel." Cool. What'd they look like? Probably our first answer, right? What'd the angel tell you? Cool. What'd the angel want you to do? Well, first when I saw the angel, I was scared. I was shaking. So that's what we read about. But they followed. We've each heard the gospel, have we not? We know what's in this book. We know the stories that are contained. We know what sin is. We know why we need a Savior. Without it, we're doomed. There we go. We get that in there too. We're doomed. It's true. We're doomed. We know who that Savior is. It's Jesus, the one and only. Other people might tell you that there's other ways, or just be a good person. Just have your good outweigh your bad. Just believe in some random God out there and you'll be okay. But we know that's not the case. Only Jesus is the way to the Father. He's the only way to heaven. He's the only way to be forgiven. No one else, nothing else can do that. We know what he can do for us, what he can do for everyone. He can give me that peace, that comfort. That's the only way for my sin to go away. The only way for me to be able to break free from sin's power is to have Jesus as King of my life. And then he's the way that shows us how we are to live. We follow his example and we're good to go. We do what he did, we're good. We don't do what he didn't do, and well, we're good. And maybe somewhere in our walk, maybe we can be as close to him as Paul was, and we can have that boldness, right? If you don't know how to follow Jesus, well, you follow me, because I'm following him closely. If you do what I do, you're on the right track. How many of us have that boldness to say that to somebody? How do I be a Christian? What do Christians do? Follow me. That takes boldness, right? Because, whoo, I got to really watch out, right? Because as soon as someone knows you're a Christian, they're going to be looking at you, hoping you mess up. Just gives them more reason not to be. Oh, you claim to be a Christian, you're no better than I am. Why should I go do that stuff and get up early on Sunday morning and write the church a check? Spend my time and money elsewhere. We are being watched. So do we share the truths contained in the Scripture by how we act and what we say? Hopefully that's a big, oh yes, I do. But if we don't, well, we can start right now. It's a great thing about God. If I took a million steps away from him, how many does it take to get back to him? One. I go a million miles away, but I turn around and, what took you so long? I've been waiting. Oh, he's the father in the prodigal son story, looking and running down the road, waiting for us to come home. But then do those we share with marvel? When we tell people, God has done this for me, are they excited? Do they care? When we hear about what God's done in someone else's life, do we marvel? That is amazing. That's great. We've been praying for you. Or have we grown cold? Have miracles lost their luster? Do we even care anymore? Or do we believe God will do things for people or even us? Do we care? Do we not care? That's a personal thing. But the people they shared with marveled, and we should too when we say, I have a praise this morning or anytime. That's amazing. Give God the credit. When a testimony is given, we should be in awe. And we should give ours so others will know what God can do. If God can get me through something, and you're going through a similar situation, but I'm not going to share about myself. You might be thinking, God can't help you. But if God can get him or her through something, he can do the same for me. That's why testimonies are important. Which again, I'll plug this evening's Bible study. The first thing we're going to do is share our story. How did you become a Christian? When did you meet Jesus? What did he save you from? Where were you? How old were you? That's what we're going to do tonight. That's not the first thing on the page. It's the second thing, or maybe even the first question. It's near the top. What is your story? Safe place to share it here. You're among family. What is your story? On to the Magi. The wise men were studying the scriptures and the signs of the times for the Messiah's appearing. You know, the Messiah, we know, was all throughout the Old Testament, foretold. The Magi, you know, they were from the same country that Daniel was. So he would have taught, and those he taught would have shared, and they knew it's time. They were searching. Because we could preach just on that. Are we studying the scriptures? Do we know what to look for? Are we keeping up with the happenings in the world? Is that what this talks about? Are we keeping up with things? Oh, the news is doom and gloom. Yeah, a lot of it is, but because we've read Revelation, we read the other end time passages. Is the end of the world pretty? No. So we do need to keep up with things. You know, we don't have to worry about it, focus on it, dwell on it, and be like, woe is me. I know whose side I'm on. I know who wins in the end. And again, as long as I'm here, Christ is with me. And if I'm not here, who am I with? What do I have to lose? It's a win-win out of the way. But regardless, we have to be ready for Jesus' return, or we have to be ready to meet him. Because one will happen either. He'll come back in my lifetime or I'll pass on. But we have to be ready. The Magi traveled all the way to worship the newborn king of the Jews. Now question, do we worship Jesus? Are we willing to travel any distance to worship Jesus? When the Magi finally made it to where Jesus was, they bowed down. We are your servants. You are the king. That's who you bow down to, is royalty. They're like, have you submitted to the lordship of Jesus? They gave him gifts. We read of gold, of frankincense, and myrrh. What gifts have we given Jesus? Worship, submission, gifts. The Magi adored, and they acted and gave accordingly. Gold was symbolic of Jesus' kingship. Do we treat Jesus as our king? Is he in control of our lives? Does he call the shots? Am I number one? I'm going to do what I want to do? Or am I running everything past God first? What do you want me to do? What can I do? Is he the king? Frankincense was highly fragrant, and it was used in worship. They used it in the temple. The gift was symbolic of Christ's deity and his willingness to be a sacrifice. He gave himself. How much of himself did he give? All. Whole. Have you given yourself to God, and are you that living sacrifice? Here I am, you can have all of me. And then myrrh was used in embalming and sometimes mixed with wine as it helped relieve pain. That's what was offered to Jesus when he was on the cross. Dipped the sponge, you know, and then offered it up on the tip of the spear. But Jesus was like, no. The gift symbolizes bitterness, suffering, and death, which foretells that Jesus would pay that ultimate price for us, for you, for me. Are we appreciative of what Jesus did? Have we repented? Are we living for him? That's really in it. Of course, the thing that is, no, come and adore Jesus. Of course, you get in the old Merriam-Webster dictionary, you'll find these definitions for adore. I like definitions. The first one is to worship or honor as a deity or as divine. You know, Jesus is that. So if I'm to adore him, I must worship and honor him. To regard with loving admiration and devotion. It's not just a one-time passing by thing. This is deep commitment. And the third one is there. It just says, to be very fond of. But this needs to go way deeper than, I'm fond of Jesus. Which I think a lot of people just want to cling to that last verse. I'm fond of him. I know who he is, and he's on the fringes of my life. But he isn't what my life is based on. Sadly, is what many people. Keep my arm's length. He's there if I need him. He's there if I get myself in trouble. But he's not the center of life. He gets the leftovers. He doesn't get the firsts. But we need to be completely devoted and committed all day, every day. So we can adore Jesus like the shepherds with expediency and by sharing the gospel and by offering praise. Those are things the shepherds did. And we can do that too. We can be quick to do things. We can share the gospel and we can praise God. We can do that. We can adore Jesus like the Magi with our studying, our worship, and our giving. They knew it was time. They saw the signs. They knew. Again, we should be studying. You know, I do study. Great. Study more. Like I do pray. That's great. Pray more. Is there ever such a thing as too much time with God? No. Well, I spent time with him. Well, that's great. We can always do more. Of course, Christmas time is nice, right? But we don't have to wait until December to adore Jesus. He's the perfect gift for us. He can provide us with peace and mercy and grace and forgiveness. And he's our example. What in the world should I be doing? Well, what did Jesus do? One thing I read before says, you know, if you only had one day left to live, what would you do? You know what Jesus did with his last day? He washed feet. Kind of puts things in a different perspective, right? I've got one day to live. What can I do? Well, Jesus served. He's also the perfect gift we can and should share with others. And we should be mindful of the gifts that we give to him and to others, and there can be overlap. We can give of our time, our resources, our skills, our abilities. There's things that we all can do. And there's things I can do that you guys might not be able to, and vice versa. You guys have a lot of skills that I don't have that I probably love to have. But I don't know how to do it. And if I know how to do something, or you know how to do something, and we don't do it, is it going to get done? No. Or if I know someone that you don't, or you know someone that I don't, if we don't reach out to them, there's no guarantee someone else will. Like your neighbors are not mine. Your family's not mine. Your friends, coworkers, people you used to work with, you know, again, sometimes there is overlap. But there's some things and some people that only you can do and reach. Same for me. We should give Jesus our first and our best. We should use what we've been given Again, those talents, skills, abilities, resources, we all have something that we can use to build his kingdom. Again, it's his kingdom. We're just part of it. To share the gospel, to enlarge and strengthen the church and our local body. Remember that, yes, when someone gets saved, they join the universal church, the eternal church. But we also have a commitment here to our local church, our local congregation, our local family. So here in July, again, when it's hot, when we're not thinking about decorating or putting up lights or going shopping or making travel schedules, who are we going to go see when and how much time are we doing that and when can we get back to do all these other things or when's the parade or and when's this going on and that going on? We can just adore him for who he is. He's our Savior. Of course, we follow it up with sharing and care and actions. So we preach to the kids a lot. Look for care and actions. Keep your eyes open. Keep your ears open. What can I do to help somebody? Be present in people's lives and the lives of this congregation. Then, of course, and then give presents that impact eternity. I will pray for you. That impacts eternity. I've got a verse for you that impacts eternity. Do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Because that's the biggest thing that impacts eternity, right? If you do know him and you do serve him, well, we know where eternity is. Heaven with God forever. Peace. Of course, the opposite is, well, the opposite. Eternity without God in darkness, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Without God. That's the big thing. So adore Jesus, serve him, and serve others.